What happens when you rip the starter motor out of your car? Well, it doesn't start. What happens when you rip the 100 gigawatt starter out of a fusion reactor? Well, it turns out it works even better. That's exactly what the American company TAE Technologies just did, proving that their impossible machine is actually simple. But how is this even possible? Well, let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Delete Me. So what exactly is this company and what are they doing differently? We've covered fusion a lot on this channel and we've seen some amazing and very exciting things, but it's rare to see an actual breakthrough that really moves the needle, something that's not just a bunch of marketing hype to attract funding. It's at the heart of why I'm calling this the SpaceX of nuclear fusion, but we'll get to that in a minute. So we're talking about a company called Tri-Alpha Energy, now TAE Technologies. Let's start by saying that this isn't a startup. These guys have been working on nuclear fusion since 1998. That's 27 years, and they've made some serious progress. Nuclear fusion has been touted as the holy grail of energy for over 70 years. But in nuclear fusion, just like in a normal nuclear fission power plant, not all fuels are created equal. TAE is tackling the holy grail of fusion energy, an advanced type of fuel called hydrogen boron, or P11B. Now, we've all been told that nuclear fusion solves all the problems of nuclear fission, and it's the perfect fuel source, but it's not always that way. You see, there's a dirty little secret that most people don't realize about nuclear fusion. Most fusion projects, including the $65 billion ITER, are based on a fuel called deuterium tritium, or DT. DT is the most promising candidate for the first commercial fusion plant because it's easy to fuse, but it's far from perfect. Its reaction releases 80% of its energy as a flood of high-energy neutrons. These neutrons smash into the reactor walls, making them radioactive over time. They also use inefficient steam turbines to capture the heat and generate electricity like any other power plant, wasting valuable energy. Plus, tritium is incredibly rare. You have to breed it inside the reactor using lithium, which adds a whole new layer of nuclear complexity and waste. This is why TAE is playing a different game. Their goal is to use the real holy grail of fusion energy, the P11B fuel cycle. The P11B reaction is what physicists call aneutronic. It doesn't release neutrons. Its main byproduct is harmless helium. No unwanted side reactions, no radioactive waste, no breeding. And the fuel? It uses normal hydrogen, like the ones in water, and boron, which you'll find in rocks everywhere. We're talking about fuels that are hundreds of times more abundant in the Earth's crust than deuterium and billions of times more abundant than tritium. It's incredibly easy and safe to extract, purify, and store, and it's so abundant that it's virtually endless. It's easy to see that this is the ultimate clean energy source. So then why is everyone using the messier DT fuel instead? This is the graph of fusion reactivity in different fuels. Down here is DT. It ignites in a mild 5 to 10 keVs around 150 million degrees Celsius. Way over here to the right is P11B. To get a comparable reaction rate to DT, you don't need 150 million degrees. You need somewhere between 1 and 5 billion degrees. Not only that, each DT reaction releases 17.6 mega electron volts of energy. The P11B reaction, only 8.68 mega electron volts. This means the energy gain, or Q factor, of DT is massive. That means that you can get 1800 kilowatt hours of energy out from every 1 kilowatt hour of energy you put in. For P11B, the absolute maximum theoretical gain is only around 30. So then to recap, you have to get your fuel 30 times hotter to get a fraction of the energy for a much lower overall gain. But that's only half the story. A lot of the topics we cover are counterintuitive or not immediately obvious. You know what's really not obvious? How exposed your personal information is online. And why I've been a member of Delete Me, our sponsor this week, for nearly 3 years. Delete Me is a hands-free subscription service that removes your personal information that's being sold online. It is completely legal for data brokers to collect your name, phone number, and address and sell to anyone with a credit card. But Delete Me has your back. They continuously remove your data online using their own tech and don't outsource to third parties. And it's not just one time. Delete Me constantly monitors the web and removes your data from hundreds of data brokers. I just got my 11th quarterly report. Delete Me scanned over 1,900 listings, and thanks to their constant diligence, my data didn't appear anywhere in this last quarter. Amazing progress from the early reports that I got when I first joined. And Delete Me has family plans to protect your entire family's personal data. We all have a lot on our minds, so join Delete Me and let them take care of that for you so you have one less thing to worry about. Get started today and save 20% on all plans using my code Ricky. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Delete Me and you. Now back to the show. To even attempt to burn P11B, you need a machine that can hold a 5 billion degree plasma. A tokamak like ITER just can't handle that. It can only reach about 150 million degrees C. Its design is like using a 100-ton hydraulic press to hold a grape. It's all magnet, no plasma. The only machine that even has a chance is the field reverse configuration FRC. This is what TAE and Helion use. But what exactly is that? These machines use strong magnetic fields to confine the hot plasma, because there are no materials in the universe capable of withstanding 150 million degrees Celsius, let alone 5 billion. In a tokamak like the one we're building in Europe, you have a donut-shaped machine with D-shaped magnets that compress the plasma in midair like a hula hoop. The magnets do all the compressing. In an FRC, instead of a hula hoop of plasma, it's a spinning football. And because it's spinning, it creates its own magnetic field holding itself together. The plasma pressure is the magnetic pressure, so you don't need such strong magnets. And at a higher beta, you're going to get more energy out than in for a fixed magnetic field. That's what makes it possible to run with advanced fuels like HB11. It's the only way to hold something that hot. But this is where we hit the 50-year-old fatal flaw. Theory said that FRC was hopelessly unstable. It suffers from something called the tilt instability. The plasma football just wants to flip over and slam onto the reactor wall in microseconds. For decades, the textbooks said FRCs were a dead end. But TAE, like SpaceX, looked at the impossible and engineered a solution. Breakthrough 1. Solving the tilt. TAE's first great idea was to use neutral beams as a gyroscope. On their Norman machine, also called C2W, they installed 8 giant particle beams that fire onto the plasma, spinning it up like a top, and it actually worked. They proved the 50-year-old dogma wrong. But to create that initial plasma football, they used the old-school method, theta pinching. This is the 100 gigawatt starter that I was talking about in the beginning. Their machine had 2 giant complex plasma cannons at each end. They'd fire 2 plasma rings at each other at supersonic speeds just to start the reaction. It was complex, violent, and incredibly expensive. Then a lead scientist, Thomas Roche, had a crazy SpaceX kind of idea. He basically went to the team and said, hey, what if we just turn off the 100 gigawatt starter and just see what happens? This is the engineering equivalent of Elon Musk saying, forget landing legs, let's just catch the rocket with giant chopsticks. It sounds absurd until it isn't. And it worked. In April 2025, they published a paper in Nature Communications. For the first time in history, they successfully formed a hot, dense, stable FRC directly from the neutral beams alone. This is a massive breakthrough. They literally tore out the most complex hardware, including 2 long, expensive quartz tubes. This simplification alone slashed the machine's capital cost by up to 50%. And the craziest part? The machine performed better. Key plasma metrics almost doubled. It's more efficient, way more compact, and it makes guiding the exhaust particles into the expansion chamber to generate electricity much simpler. This is a colossal win, but TAE is not at the finish line yet. They have now engineered a path to a 5 billion degree furnace, but they still have to survive it. Their Norman machine hit 75 million degrees Celsius. Their new Norm machine is pushing that higher. But to get it to the 1 to 5 billion degrees needed for Da Vinci, they need a 13 to 70 times increase. That will require neutral beams hundreds of times more powerful than what we have now. But the real final boss is radiation. At these insane temperatures, the plasma starts bleeding energy. It's a physics problem called Brennstrahlung, or breaking radiation. When a fast-moving electron from the plasma zips past a heavy boron nucleus, also from the plasma, the nucleus's powerful charge yanks on it, causing it to break and shed its energy as a high-powered X-ray. This is an energy loss, and it gets worse as the temperatures go up. Many physicists believe this is the true deal breaker. They estimate that for P11B, the energy lost to Brennstrahlung radiation will be more than the energy you gain from fusion. You'll never get ignition. And this is a massive fundamental problem. It's like trying to fill a bucket with a giant hole at the bottom. But TAE's high beta FRC is the only design that has a chance to beat it. It is anything but easy. But here's the thing. This is the team that proved that beam instability simulations were wrong by discovering a self-healing plasma that just spits out the bad particles. And this is the team that has the guts to rip the 100 gigawatt starter out of their multi-billion dollar machine on a hunch. And we're right about it. As an engineer, this is the kind of thing that you bet on. They just might figure this out. I know I've used the analogy to SpaceX, but a lot of this story reminds me so much of SpaceX. Just imagining everything, throwing out the playbook, and just starting fresh. Because oftentimes, as engineers, we stand on the shoulders of giants. We're told what works, what doesn't, use this alloy for this kind of manufacturing, and then we follow those rules because they're tried and true. But what if the assumptions are wrong? What if there actually is a way to rethink something? Reusable rockets have brought down space launch prices thanks to SpaceX. We might be looking at the next frontier of that true dream power source, nuclear fusion. But what do you guys think? Is the P-11 dream an impossible physics nightmare? Or is this the team that will finally figure this out? Sound off in the comments below. We'll have more information on the story as we find out in our newsletter. So check the links below to join that. Also join our Discord for chatting about some of the topics that we cover. And until next week, I'm Ricky Tutta Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.